coming, you know, the number of children who are coming to us with orbital disease comprise more than 1/4 of all cases of retinoblastoma. And so we really wanted to work in this area. So, as you all know, retinoblastoma is curable if it's detected in the early stages. But in untreated cases, extraocular spread can occur, and this can occur either through the optic nerve or through the sclera. So though it's rare in the developed countries, it is not an unusual feature in the developing world, where it constitutes 20-50% of all retinoblastoma cases. Now, the management of orbital retinoblastoma remains a challenge, as it is associated with a 10-27 times higher risk of metastasis when compared with cases that present without orbital extension. So you all know that in the past it was treated with orbital excentration, and orbital excentration is a very radical, mutilating and disfiguring surgery. So excentration is no longer used as a first-line treatment, and there is increasing evidence in the literature that if we have a multimodal treatment approach that combines neoadjuvant chemotherapy, surgery, orbital radiotherapy, it can improve patient survival. So when we searched the literature, we found that studies on extraocular retinoblastoma were few. And whatever was there, they were conducted on heterogeneous populations. Means the patients, the subjects were in different stages of the disease. Some had non-metastatic extraocular disease, some had metastatic extraocular disease. So it was not a uniform, homogeneous population. The studies were retrospective, the number of patients were very small, different classification systems were used, so interpretation became difficult, and there was a lack of consensus on chemotherapy protocols. Investigators had used different kind of protocols for different studies. So because of this, we thought, okay, let's conduct a randomized prospective comparative study on multimodal therapy for stage 3 retinoblastoma. And the stage 3 retinoblastoma was cases of orbital retinoblastoma, and we used the international retinoblastoma system to classify these patients. The study was published in the Ophthalmology Journal, and I'll just take you briefly through what we did in this study. So the purpose of this study was to compare the efficacy and safety of two chemotherapeutic combinations in stage 3 retinoblastoma cases that were treated with neoadjuvant chemotherapy, initiation, orbital radiotherapy, and adjuvant chemotherapy. So it was a prospective randomized comparative study. It was a single center study. We recruited patients between 2011 and 2014. And the inclusion criteria consisted of stage 3A retinoblastoma. And we used the Champidas classification for this, which meant they all had regional orbital extension, but none of them had lymph node disease. The patients who presented with metastatic disease, that is stage 4, and those with history of prior treatment, or those parents who are not willing to participate in the study or for follow-up, were excluded. Now, we recorded the baseline history and demographic details. Ophthalmic general physical and systemic examination was carried out. We did investigations depending upon what was required. We scanned ultrasound or contrast enhanced MRIs, the orbits and brain for staging the disease, and incision biopsy of the orbital mass whenever it was required. Systemic investigations were done, the blood biochemistry, ultrasound of the abdomen, chest x-ray, echocardiography, CSF examination, and bone marrow aspiration and biopsy was done by our pediatric oncology team. So children who fulfilled the inclusion criteria were randomized into two groups according to computer-generated random numbers. Group A cases were treated with triple drug chemotherapy, and group B cases were treated with a 5-drug combination. I'll be describing the chemotherapy protocol in detail over here. So this is the chemotherapy protocol that we used. You can see over here, this is the group A. We used V, E and C. They were given at 3 weekly intervals, a total of 12 cycles. These were the doses. If you note, the vincristine dose is lower than what we use for standard BEC therapy. The etoposide was stepped up, and so was the carboplatin. For group B cases, we used 5 drugs in alternating cycles. So for etoposide and carboplatin, they were given at 3 weekly intervals, 4 times. Vincristine, cyclophosphamide, and idarubicin were given together, again 4 cycles, alternating with etoposide and carboplatin. These were the doses that were used, and these were the days on which the chemotherapy was administered on each cycle. So the response to treatment was assessed on clinical examination as well as on MRI of the brain and orbits, and this was performed after 3 cycles of chemotherapy. After that, once we had an adequate response on chemotherapy and the tumor had shrunk, enucleation was carried out and a primary PMMA implant was inserted. So this is one patient to show how this child presented to us, this 3-year-old girl. In the left eye, she had orbital retinoblastoma. You can see on the MRI, the optic nerve is thickened right up till here, and there is a huge orbital mass. It showed a wonderful dramatic response after 3 cycles of neoadjuvant chemotherapy, which you can also appreciate on the MRI scans. So after enucleation, we went ahead with orbital external beam radiotherapy, which was administered to the orbit within 4 to 6 weeks of enucleation. It was given in doses of 40 gray in 20 fractions, which is the protocol that we use for all cases of extraocular retinoblastoma. And adjuvant chemotherapy was continued after surgery according to the treatment protocol. So the outcome measures were the survival probability, the cause of death, and chemotherapy-related toxicity. So we recruited 54 children, 27 in each group. These included 32 boys and 22 girls and had a median follow-up of 25.4 months. Now, of these 54 cases, 24 children expired. The overall Kaplan-Meier survival probability was 80% at 1 year and 42% at 4 years. This is for the overall, all 54 cases, not comparing A and B, 80% at 1 year and 42% at 4 years.
Of the cases that passed away, unilateral incisional biopsy.
So the ones that had unilateral disease had incisional biopsy. Some of them had bilateral, so we didn't do a biopsy. So there were 9 deaths in group A and 15 deaths in group B. Now this is comparing group A and group B now, the survival probability. Now interestingly, at 1 year, the survival probability was similar in both groups. 81% and 79% for group A and B respectively. But what happened at 4 years? At 4 years, we found that the survival probability for group A cases was much higher than for group B, with a strong trend of better survival among group A cases over time that was statistically significant. So this is displayed in the graph over here. You have this group A and you have this group B. Now if you remember, group A was treated with the three drug protocol, the VEC, and B was treated with the 5-drug protocol. So though it seems that initially at 1 year it was comparable, 81% and 79%, at 4 years, group A had a significantly better survival than group B did. Now we assessed the grades of tumor response on MRI. We did a baseline MRI and when we repeated the MRI after 3 cycles of chemotherapy, we subclassified the response into a complete response, a partial response, no response, and progressive disease. And again, when we compared group A versus group B, we found a complete response in more patients with group who were treated by group A protocol than by group B. And we found more patients of progressive disease treated by group B than by group A, again showing a better response in group A. Now coming to the cause of death. We analyzed the cause of death in both the groups and we found that the major cause of death in both groups was CNS relapse. 8 children in group A and 7 in group B died of CNS relapse. In addition, in group B, 4 children also died of hematogenous metastasis. Chemotherapy-related toxicity was more significant among group B cases and 2 children expired due to sepsis following drug toxicity, reflecting the more toxic nature of group B drugs. We also saw the percentage of cases that had 1 or more episodes of grade 3 or grade 4 chemotoxicity. This included all hematological toxicities, including thrombocytopenia, anemia, thrombocytopenia, and neutropenia. So we determined that in each group. And grade 4 neutropenia was more significant in group B as compared to group A cases, and the difference was statistically significant. Grade 4 thrombocytopenia and anemia and grade 3 hematological toxicities were also more common in group B as compared to group A, although the difference was not statistically significant. So So this is the chart. We have used the National Cancer Institute Common Terminology Criteria to grade the adverse events, the version 4.03. And over here you can see the chart. As far as grade 4 neutropenia is concerned, you can see it was much more in group B as compared to group A. It was statistically significant. It was also higher in all the other categories, although the difference was not significant. So when we searched the literature, we found that literature on optal retinoblastoma was sparse and treatment strategies were still evolving. Previous studies had reported a 3 to 5 year survival ranging from 40% to 84% for orbital retinoblastoma. So we did this study, and to the best of our knowledge, it's the first randomized prospective study that has compared two significantly different treatment protocols for stage 3 retinoblastoma. So what did we conclude from this study? We found triple dart chemotherapy with a VC combination to be more efficacious and less toxic as compared to etoposide and carboplatin alternating with cyclophosphamide, idarubicin and vincristine. Hence, we would like to recommend VC protocol as neoadjuvant and adjuvant chemotherapy for orbital retinoblastoma. This work was supported by a grant from Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. This is a bibliography relevant to this paper. Thank you for your time.
I'd like to open that to questions, but first I'd like to give an extra clap for Bhavna for doing this very beautiful, meaningful, significant study that